Great. All right. Well, thank you all for coming today. I'm really excited to share some of these ideas that, you know, we've been working on for some time now and have translated to a lot of learnings with our users, customers, product, and really just wanted to start a more open conversation with the community about some you know, design principles that we see as really, really practical and critical for developing AI applications in a more effective way. And so to start, I'd love to just introduce myself quickly here. I'm Vincent, as some of you may have guessed. And I started working on the Snorkel project about 4 years ago, back when it was still a research project at the Stanford AI Lab, you know, contributing to the core open source library, contributing to the academic literature, interfaces, applications, and collaborations. And since then, you know, I and many other snorkelers have worked to build and deploy a number of these complex AI applications, you know, supporting our users and customers. And today I lead the ML engineering team, where that is a big part of our mandate. So given those learnings, I'd love to share some of the perspectives that we've gleaned from, you know, numerous sorts of deployments that we think would be really, really helpful to share with the broader community. And so at its core, what we found is that when we're building these sorts of production models, they're often much more complex than, say, benchmark or academic data sets, right? These models are need to be production ready. They need to be maintainable. And in a lot of cases, it's actually insufficient to use something like a, you know, black box end-to-end, you know, fully differentiable model for a number of engineering reasons, right? They're not as modular or debuggable, or you can't really introspect the intermediate outputs. These are all principles that are normally pretty common with software development, but for some reason we've lost that in the, you know, in the time that we've gone to these bigger and more end-to-end and more black box models. And today I want to talk about a few cases where, you know, while these models are great, it actually helps and has a significant benefit to be able to decompose problems in a little bit more of an engineering friendly way. And so to talk about this, I'd love to start with a case study covering a specific application that I've actually seen and worked on deployed in several high value settings. And so in this case, we're working on a social media monitoring application, right? Where the goal specifically is to say, can we build an AI application that monitors the sentiment of Fortune 500 companies on Twitter? Put in other words, that's to say, hey, if Nokia or GameStop are mentioned in tweets, can we figure out if they're being mentioned in positive, negative, or neutral lights, right? That you can imagine this being a really impactful application for different, you know, customer complaint detection applications, for just, just general market analysis applications. This is one particular example of a complex application where I'd love to talk through some of these design principles with. And so how would I get started, right? If I'm a good data scientist, right? I'm probably following all the big names on Twitter, and I've probably heard about some fancy end-to-end model, right? Where I can just do this all in one go, where I can, you know, train my model, pass in raw inputs, and get a, you know, fully well-formatted predictions out at the token or document level. And so when I come to evaluate this, I might find that it's actually not ready for deployment yet, right? The F1 score might actually be lower than I expect or am comfortable with for deployment. And so as a data scientist working in a team, I might bring this problem to stand up and get some thoughts from my teammates. And so, you know, after going to stand up, we see that, you know, getting a ton of really, really positive feedback, you know, feedback like, hey, how do I actually, you know where the mistakes are coming from? Are we missing company mentions? Are we misclassifying the sentiment of each company? You know, my teammate Roberto maybe has mentioned, hey, you know, I actually scraped a list of Fortune 500 companies last quarter for a project that I did. Like, if you want to use that, I could point you to it on GitHub. I get a ton of these ideas, but I'm kind of stuck because I don't have the right abstractions or workflows or interfaces to really edit or modify our end-to-end model, right? It's really hard to modify or refine specific components of it. And that's where we come to our main problem here, right? That practitioners need new workflows to support what we call this practical AI development workflow. It's these settings where, you know, we realize that, hey, it's not just a single model, it's not just a single score that's important. It's the ability to look at component-wise, you know, scores. It's the ability to debug those components, to view end-to-end metrics where appropriate. And these sorts of engineering principles, which again are very common in traditional software engineering, somehow haven't quite translated to the AI ML system design domain. And again, this is a trend that, you know, isn't an observation, you know, that only we've made. You know, Sumith, the creator of PyTorch, had a really great tweet that you know, we resonated with here at Snorkel, indicating that, hey, yeah, actually, you know, deep learning on its own isn't going to be able to solve these real world problems, right? You need your priors, you need your post-processing and pre-processors and business logic and engineering. How do we actually build a system with support for all of these sorts of, you know, engineering friendly principles as first class citizens? And that's where a lot of our learnings have come in. And so in the next few slides, I'll cover how, you know, with this motivating example in mind, how we actually think about building AI applications in a little bit of a different way, given the issues and problems and friction points that I had mentioned in the earlier slide. So first, down with the end-to-end mega model, right? This is to say that while some problems can be solved with a single end-to-end model that goes from raw inputs to end outputs, you know, we've seen our users and customers actually find that this doesn't replace the advantage of having a modular composable system, right? It doesn't replace the need for testing out multiple models, switching them in and out, testing different pre-processing pipelines, different business logic to actually format the end outputs into something that's usable. Like any piece of infrastructure ends up being really, really important to have this composable pipeline. And so just thinking that a single end-to-end model will solve all of our problems is a little bit of a misguided way to think about building these more complex applications. Second, you know, while modularity is really, really important to the development process, it's equally important to evaluate and iterate on the end-to-end application, right? That's to say, having a global application view beyond just individual models or preprocessors should be a first-class citizen in the practitioner's workflow, right? It should be really easy to zoom out a level and see, okay, how am I doing in aggregate? Am I actually solving the product or business problem that I set out to do? And if not, how do I get there? Third, as I've alluded to, you know, machine learning shouldn't be the universal default for solving these problems, right? Once we break a problem down into its you know, requisite components, it's equally important to avoid assuming that every component is, you know, some big fancy deep learning model, you know, no matter how many great tweets we see about the latest architectures, right? The key is to start with sensible defaults, often heuristics, and then use that organizational knowledge to you know, kick off and bootstrap your pipeline. And then based on empirical error analysis, right? If the system says, hey, actually, this specific, you know, heuristic or ontology lookup is underperforming, we can replace it with a learned ML component to improve the performance. And this ends up being much more practical because we end up being able to use some of these resources and use these heuristics and get to that end-to-end workflow as quickly as possible without spending too much time, you know, debugging what ends up being a black box without really understanding where the gaps are in performance. And finally, it ends up being really important to be able to adapt, you know, each one of these applications using something like a programmatic labeling technique as we support in Snorkel, right? Real world applications don't really work well with off-the-shelf models, right? They're built over custom data distributions, custom problem definitions that are specific to your organization. And it's not the case where we can just rely on pre-trained models, you know, on that were trained on completely different data sets or problem settings, right? It's often really important to be able to use an approach like Snorkel to quickly build out these models, quickly, you know, create training data, train models, and iterate on those models in a really, really effective and rapid way to make this thing actually, you know, tenable, right? And this is to say, as you're building these models, having a way to adapt each subcomponent to your actual problem setting is made possible by the programmatic labeling approach that we, you know, support in Snorkel. If you want to learn more about this, if you're less familiar with how Snorkel supports these sorts of workflows, I recommend reading some of our other blog posts on how Snorkel's programmatic labeling approach can help you, you know, rapidly build these sorts of high quality applications. But I'll defer a lot of those topics to, you know, different talks or blog posts, and focus on our end-to-end development goals in this one. All right. So with these design principles in mind, I'd love to cover a few, you know, key concepts, key abstractions that we can use to actually start building AI applications that we found really, really helpful in our own settings. So first, we have this notion of an operator as a building block, right? And an operator is actually a very simple concept. It's this idea that, hey, we want a function that performs some sort of transformation over one or more data frames. And, you know, an operator has a specific type signature, right? It has, you know, in this case, in this example, the operator is a classifier which takes in a document data frame. In this case, maybe corresponding to an email with a subject, body, and timestamp, and transforms that data frame by adding an extra prediction column, which indicates, hey, is my email a spam or is it a normal email, right? So this is a great example of an operator where, you know, it has this type signature, email in, email with prediction out. And you can imagine, you know, all different sorts of operators, right? Some that do pre-processing, some that you maybe trim white space or, you know, apply spacey entities to your body to do some downstream processing, some that apply, you know, post-processing or business logic to your application. Each one of these operators ends up being a really critical and composable building block for your application in aggregate. But one of the most important properties of these operators are that they're modular, right? And that's to say that you can implement the same operator, you know, with the same type signature using a number of different implementations. Take our email classification operator as an example. You know, you could just start with a heuristic that says, hey, if the term free money shows up in my email, let's classify it as spam, right? This would be what we call a heuristic operator because it is literally just using some sort of, you know, pattern-based heuristic to make the classification. Or of course, right, we could use a learned operator, you know, based on some sklearn model, some Hugging Face model, to use more advanced features or richer representations to make the sorts of classification, right? To the platform, it's all the same sort of operator because the type signature matches. But to the developer, this ends up being a really powerful abstraction because you're able to independently modify, swap, and debug these individual building blocks. Awesome. So next, we come to our definition of an AI application, which more formally is a directed acyclic DAG, a directed acyclic graph or a DAG, which is implemented over one or more operators, right? So that's to say that an application can be composed of models, preprocessors, heuristics, and additional business logic to actually solve the business or product problem that you're trying to address with your specific AI system. And critically, I think, you know, one of the things that ends up being really, really helpful in these settings is to have a notion of an application template, right? Which can be used to templatize a lot of the sorts of recommended workflows across different domains. You can imagine in our social media monitoring setting, there could be a recommended path to saying, hey, how do we pull out companies, classify them, get to the entity level score. And I'm foreshadowing a little bit here, but having this notion of a template makes it really easy to start with sensible defaults and iterate from there. So the last key concept I want to cover here is this idea that, hey, once you have these operators in place, once you understand that they can be composed into some more complex end-to-end application, it's really critical to be able to diagnose quality at the local and global level, right? That's to say, you want to understand how each operator is doing independently, but you also want to know how the application as a whole is doing, right? Whether you're actually solving the downstream business problem that you set out to address in the first place. Having this you know, component-wise view in addition to the global view makes it really, really easy to focus development efforts. And this ends up being a really helpful, you know, pattern when it comes to practically building these sorts of applications, right? You're able to actually tell, hey, you know, this component or this operator in my pipeline is underperforming. Maybe I should spend a little bit of effort here rather than the other parts, which are actually doing quite well. So with these concepts in mind, I want to revisit our earlier application where we were trying to build this social media monitoring app and see how, you know, some of these key concepts can be done, can be utilized to actually, can be put to practice to solve this particular problem rather than using an end-to-end model. So again, our goal here is to build an AI application that monitors the sentiment of Fortune 500 companies that are mentioned on Twitter. And so to start, like I alluded to, we can use what's available in Application Studio or Snorkel Flow, or you know, what we call an entity classification template, right? And I'll go into some of these details in just a second, but the main idea here is to say, this is a recommended approach based on this specific, you know, domain industry specific problem for how to break apart the problem into more manageable subcomponents. You know, we'll have recommended labeling functions, recommended models for each part of the pipeline. But the main idea here is to say, you know, using a set of sensible defaults that are kind of built in, we can really, really easily just bootstrap an end-to-end application, understand where the gaps are, and dive in there. For the purpose of this demo, you know, normally you wouldn't have to kind of go through each part one by one, because, you know, you would just kind of focus on the parts that need additional attention. For the purpose of this webinar, I'll dive into individual components so it's easier to understand. But yeah, in the actual platform, right, you could presumably initialize all of this at once with sensible defaults, and then, you know, come back to individual portions as necessary. So let's start with the entity tagger in this case, right? So when we think about what we're trying to do here, we're trying to pull out all company mentions from our tweets. And if you recall, you know, at standup, I remember Roberto had mentioned, hey, actually, I had scraped, you know, a list of Fortune 500 companies in a project that I was working on previously. Why not just take advantage of that, right? And so that's actually a very sensible thing to do. It would be an example of a heuristic operator in this case, where, hey, maybe using a fuzzy matching approach based on that list of companies scraped by Roberto, I can actually include it into my pipeline and quickly get up and running without any ML at all in this case, right? So this is to say, I'll start with this heuristic example. I'll take advantage of an organizational resource that my teammate has, and I'll just move through the pipeline and make progress without getting stuck on this part or defaulting to some fancy model when it might not actually be necessary, or rather when we don't know if it'll be necessary. So awesome. Now we have a way to get from tweets to company mentions, you know, defined by maybe character offsets within each tweet, to pull out these Fortune 500 companies. The next step in my pipeline is to actually classify each mention based on the surrounding context. Right, in this case, you know, I might use Snorkel Flow's kind of built-in defaults around, you know, a TF-IDF classifier, right, around the surrounding context, maybe 200 tokens to the left and right of each one of my company mentions. I can use this to get spun up, you know, use Snorkel to write some labeling functions, quickly build a model here, and really quickly commit a model that's pretty simple, but again, easy to come back to and iterate on. To perform this sentiment classification for each one of my company mentions. So again, this is saying, hey, for each company in my document, I'm going to treat it as a separate example. I'm going to train a model to classify its sentiment, whether it's being mentioned in a positive, negative, or neutral light. And that model is going to use as features the surrounding context with a very simple, maybe logistic regression TF-IDF model to get us started. Awesome. So again, now we have a set of classified company mentions, but what we really want isn't really mention level predictions, right? What we really want is entity level predictions. And I'll clarify what I mean there. By mention level predictions, I mean, you know, each company can actually be mentioned in a number of different formats, right? Nokia can show up as Nokia, it can show up as Nokia Corp. It could show up as the stock ticker symbol. It could have a number of different forms. But what we really want is to say, hey, is Nokia in general being mentioned in a positive or negative light across the entire document? I don't really care about the, you know, the mention level prediction. I care about the entity level prediction. And so one step to getting there is to say, I want to link each one of my mentions in my tweets. So Nokia, Nokia Corp, GameStop, each one of these mentions is going to be linked to a canonical entity, right? In this case, it's going to be the stock ticker symbol. And so the goal here again is to say Nokia and Nokia Corp are actually referring to the same entity. Let's make sure that we have an ID associated with them. So we actually know this when we're using business logic in the downstream application. And again, you know, as a very simple approach here, I'm seeing that there's a ton of character overlap between each one of my mentions and the actual stock ticker symbol. Why don't we just use a very heuristic entity linker in this case? Maybe using a sort of fuzzy matching approach to match each one of the company mentions to its most likely entity, right? So again, this is an example of a heuristic operator where, of course, we could go off the shelf and of course we could pull in, you know, one of the state-of-the-art entity disambiguation models, from the Hugging Face library, maybe, you know, the Transformers library to do this. But to get started, you know, why not just use a very simple approach? And if it works, you know, that's great. We don't have to spend the time debugging and training and spending compute resources on something that we don't even know is necessary yet. Great. So now that we have the linked entities, we can apply some downstream business logic to get at this entity level prediction, as I had mentioned, right? So we have classifications for each one of our mentions. We have a way to link them to its canonical entity. We can apply what we call a reducer to reduce the mention level prediction to entity level predictions, right? So that's to say, I'm going to use again another heuristic to say, hey, just give me the most common prediction for all the mentions of Nokia, and I'll treat that as the entity level prediction for Nokia, right? If Nokia was mentioned in a positive light 2 out of 3 times in the document, let's just say that overall for this particular tweet, the classification of Nokia is positive. And so this reducer is a way to heuristically aggregate these mention level predictions into entity level sentiments. Awesome. So now we have our end-to-end pipeline. And you know, if we were to zoom out again to that overall application level view, we can try and understand where the gaps in performance are actually coming from, right? Are they coming from we're seeing that the end-to-end score is maybe not as high as we'd want it to be. And we're also seeing that, hey, maybe the biggest contributor to our poor performance is this particular operator in the beginning of our pipeline, right? This really drives home this idea that using both local and global application scores, we can prioritize some of our development effort. Awesome. So I see a question from Ezri from the chat. So repeating it, since the operators in the application are set up sequentially, does the application studio UI easily allow the downstream operator to determine if it's performing badly? So if I'm answering your question correctly, hopefully this slide actually shows how we can do that, right? The UI will be able to indicate, hey, there are certain subcomponents that are struggling relative to others. And that's contributing likely to the poor overall performance. And so it'll give you that information. As a developer, you can then focus there and see if that actually improves performance, which is exactly what we'll do in these next few slides. Awesome. So let's iterate on the entity tagger, right? A very reasonable thing to do is maybe, you know, grab our, favorite transformer from our friends at Hugging Face and try to learn a sequence model to do a sequence tagging problem over individual company mentions in the document, right? So this is to say, instead of using an ontology or a heuristic to do a fuzzy match over companies, maybe that approach wasn't that good. Like maybe Roberta's dictionary was not as high quality as I would have liked, and I would actually prefer to replace that with a state-of-the-art ML model and spend some effort here. That's totally fine, right? Because the operators are modular, it's very easy to swap out I'm the heuristic operator for a learned one. And again, right, this is something that we'll develop with Snorkel using our programmatic labeling techniques, right? We'll be able to really easily create training data, train a model, and iterate over this particular model using the key abstractions in Snorkel, which helps us adapt, you know, the pre-trained models, which are great from Hugging Face, to your specific problem or, you know, this specific set of tweets that we care about in particular. Great. So now that we've spent a little bit of time iterating on the entity tagger, let's see how that affects our overall performance. You know, lo and behold, let's say that, hey, we've replaced this entity tagger with one that's now learned. And indeed, that does improve our global score, right? Obviously, this is an example of what a workflow might look like, but it's actually, you know, maps pretty closely to the types of debugging and iterative development loops that we see in production, right? It's often the case that, you know, we'll initialize an application, we'll look at the overall score. It won't be that great, right, to get started with, but because we're able to focus on individual subcomponents where there's maximal impact to spend, you know, frankly, really valuable developer time, we're able to prioritize efforts and, you know, really focus on debugging specific parts of the pipeline rather than maybe looking at somewhat hard to understand loss curves or you know, trying to debug a black box model where, hey, we actually have a number of tools that we could be using that are pretty hard to integrate with that end-to-end model. And so a few really important ideas here, right? This idea that, you know, iterative development should be at the center of AI application development is one of the key ideas that I want to get across, right? This idea that, hey, you should be decomposing your complex applications into more manageable subcomponents, right? It's often a much more practical way to solve problems. You know, sometimes end-to-end models work, but having this composable approach ends up giving you a ton of additional engineering advantages. You know, with your decomposed pipeline, you can then diagnose and prioritize your development efforts to focus specifically on the underperforming parts of the pipeline. And then finally, you can use Snorkel's programmatic labeling approach to really rapidly iterate on these high quality subcomponents in your pipeline to ultimately, you know, improve end-to-end performance. And so all of these ideas are made possible with Application Studio, which we shipped a few months ago. And, you know, the example I gave today, you know, of social media monitoring is just one example of many, you know, across different application types, across different data modalities that we support on the platform, right? We actually support a number of these, what we call application templates to address all sorts of problem types. And, you know, we found that this sort of approach is very general, right? It applies to all sorts of complex applications that we've seen our users and customers try and build. It ends up being a really, really effective way to not just save time, but also, you know, save some of your sanity when it comes to debugging these more complex apps. So I wanted to thank you for you know, joining us today. This is something that we are really excited to continue gathering feedback on from the community and for folks to be able to try soon in the platform. It's you know, feel free to reach out via email, via Twitter, you know, wherever it makes sense for you to, you know, continue brainstorming about these ideas. But you know, this is an area that we're really excited about, and ultimately at Snorkel we're committed to bringing, you know, practitioners the tools that will help them, you know, most practically build data-centric applications. So thanks so much for your time, and excited to follow up.